Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I thought they were going to pull out the picture of the rapping imams. Did you all ever see that one? Okay, you didn't do your homework to get the best picture of Sheikh Yasser and I together. But that's all right, we'll give you a chance to redeem yourselves by the end of the night. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi everyone. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi al-kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira. It's an absolute honor and joy and pleasure to be here. Sheikh Yasser paid this community the greatest compliment that could possibly be given to this community, which is, he said, it's just like Valley Ranch Islamic Center. That was Sheikh Yasser's description of your community, and I felt it as soon as I walked into the masjid today. Everything about the aura, the way that people greet one another, the way that people smile, Hassan face socks that don't make any sense whatsoever. Everything was just absolutely beautiful, welcoming, and had this wonderful spirit of unity and community inside of it. And subhanAllah, I want to actually share, you know, we were just talking about Muhammad Ali on the table. So Sheikh Yasser and I actually went to the janazah of Muhammad Ali. May Allah have mercy on him. And he will tell you that one of the most touching things about Muhammad Ali when you went to Louisville, Kentucky, was that every single person that you met had an Ali story. Bus driver, gas station clerk, security at the convention center, every single person had a story about Muhammad Ali coming to their school, about Muhammad Ali walking into their store, about seeing him jogging on the street one day. And the story always sounded the exact same way. It was about how he made them feel. The way he smiled at them, the way that he joked with them, the way that they saw a person who they thought was larger than life, who would have no time in the world to speak to someone of their status, honor them, dignify them, treat them with such love and such care and such dignity. And I want to stick to that theme for a moment. Because if your masjid, and I know you're fundraising tonight, so I'm not going to say just stay where you are. All right. I hope you build the building of your dreams. Alhamdulillah, we actually just moved into our center this Ramadan in Valley Ranch. And we've done our best to try to keep the spirit. In fact, we try to implement things with the construction of our new masjid that people typically would not think about when constructing a masjid. How is every single door, every color, the height of the ceiling in the women and men section, the way that everything is laid out, how is everyone going to feel welcomed and loved when they walk through the doors of the masjid? That's our motto. That was our calling. That we wanted to be the most inclusive and loving masjid in America. And it looks like y'all are going to give us a run for our money. But we'll see how it goes. We'll compete. We'll count smiles in the two masjids. But I do want to emphasize this for a moment. And it was really, you know, I was listening to a mufti from Nigeria, speaking at a conference actually, because I don't want to claim this analogy, but I thought it was a wonderful analogy. And I told him I'd give him credit, Mufti Nuruddin. We were at a conference together in Malaysia in January. And he was talking about a hotel. What makes a hotel a 3-star hotel versus a 4-star hotel versus a 5-star hotel? And then he talked about masjids. If you were to assign a rating to a masjid, what makes it a 3-star masjid, a 4-star masjid, a 5-star masjid? Now, how many stars would the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam be? 7 stars? That only exists in the UAE. It's not really a thing. They just tell people Burj Al Arab is a 7-star hotel, but it's not really a thing though. But good option. I know, like, someone would think about, like, lightning striking them if they said anything less than 5 stars for the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ. But if you think about it, right, what did the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ look like? Its simplicity, its construction. There was nothing really that impressive about the way that it was built. It was an extremely simple masjid. You had homeless people sleeping in the back of the masjid, Ahl al-Suffa. You had tents pitched in the masjid. You had utter simplicity. But what made it a five-star masjid was the feel of it, was the service of it, was the way that it that you felt when you walked into the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That you knew that you could walk in and be fulfilled and be eased, and that someone would treat you in a certain way. Now, I don't want to make this talk just about that, but I do want to emphasize this, because a lot of communities forget these foundational elements of character as their masjids grow. And as your community flourishes and becomes the second or tied for first best masjid in the country, as it grows, these are things that you're going to need to keep going back to. If you think about equality, one thing you want your community to be known by, what is it? Right? And it starts off with that incident where Abdullah ibn Salam, rahimahullah, who radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the chief rabbi, Jewish rabbi of Medina, Hussein ibn Salam at the time, went to see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was all about. He went to the area where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was addressing his companions. He said, "I saw his face," and he said, "I knew that that's not the face of a liar. I saw his smile. I saw the way he carried himself. Araftu, I just knew." He said, "I knew that that's not, laysa biwajhi kadhab, that can't be the face of a liar. That man is not lying." Before the Prophet ﷺ uttered a single word, he said, "I looked at him and I knew that's a truthful person." And his inaugural address to the people in Medina, when the Prophet ﷺ says, "Ayyuhan nas, O people, afshus salam, spread peace." He didn't say contain peace amongst yourselves. He said spread peace, afshus salam, wa at'imu ta'am, and feed one another, spread food. There's something about eating with one another. We break bread together. It's a historical part of our human bonding, right? That it's just different when there's food there. But it doesn't have to be biryani every night, but that's a different conversation that we could have about your Ramadan iftars, all right? At'imu ta'am. Feed the poor amongst you. Sit with one another and eat. Feed the people around you. Eat with your neighbors. Break bread with people. And the Prophet ﷺ said, and maintain the ties of your family. And pray at night while others are sleeping. You will enter into paradise in peace. That was the first message the Prophet ﷺ felt that he had to establish a community upon. The Prophet ﷺ did not tell the people, make sure that your masjid is built like this. Make sure that the windows look like this. Make sure you've got a door here and a door there. Make sure you've got the partition right back there. No, further back, further back, further back. Where it's almost, you know, make sure it's there. Make sure it's none of that. And one thing that I always tell people about the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, all of the sunnah is sacred. All of it is sacred. Every single element of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is beautiful and sacred. There is nothing about the sunnah that's not beautiful and sacred. Nothing. All right? I remember rocking a beard. That used to be like a thing to get people to look at you funny in an airport. Now it's like, you know, because beards are in now, right? So now when security looks at you and they say, "Hey man, how long did it take you to grow that? How do I get there?" Right? Now things have changed. I can't imagine what they do with you, Sheikh. I got no clue, man. They probably ask you a lot of like tips and questions about your beard, you know. It'll take some time for me to get there. But the point is, subhanAllah, everything about the sunnah, right? You know, and I do this as an experiment for people on an individual level. I say, when you think sunnah, when the word sunnah is said in your presence, what are the themes that come to your head? You know, when you do rapid fire, like I did this at Duke University, I said, I'm going to say a word and I want you to respond. I said, famous Muslim, Osama bin Laden, Saddam Hussein, like everyone said like a name of a terrorist, all right? So sunnah. What comes to your mind? Quick, like rapid fire. It's already been too long. But what comes to your mind? Huh? Mercy. Compassion. Don't give me the stuff you think I'm supposed to hear. When the word, what does the word sunnah evoke? You've been thinking about it too long. That's what it is. Two rak'ahs. That's honesty. Not that y'all aren't honest. All right? But usually when you say the word sunnah, the words that it triggers are rituals. And they are sunnah. The two rak'ahs matter. They could be the reason a person enters into Jannah. Everything about the Prophet ﷺ is beautiful. But how do we prioritize within the sunnah? Doesn't it make sense that we look at what Allah praised about the Prophet ﷺ most, and that those should be the most prominent elements of the sunnah when we think sunnah? What are the qualities of the Prophet ﷺ that Allah praised most? وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are on an exalted standard of character. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you except as a mercy to the worlds. وَدُّ لَوْ تُدْهِنُ فَيُدْهِنُونَ. You're a man of integrity. They wish you would compromise on your principles. They would readily compromise on theirs. The things that Allah praises the Prophet ﷺ for should be the most dominant elements when we think of sunnah. Likewise, should we not prioritize, if we want every masjid to emulate the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, should we not prioritize what the Prophet ﷺ prioritized? Should we not think the way the Prophet ﷺ thought when establishing a community about what was most important when establishing that community? And how do we infuse that and bring that back into the masjid today? That's how we prioritize. What did the Prophet ﷺ prioritize? What did he say? What did he think were the fundamentals of the community? And I want to get back to particularly Abdullah ibn Salam and what he saw from the Prophet ﷺ. If the Prophet ﷺ had said the exact same words, but he said them screaming with anger, would it have had the same effect on Abdullah ibn Salam? Right? So, if the Prophet ﷺ would have read them off a paper, أَيُّهَا النَّاسَ أَفْشُوا السَّلَامُ وَأَطْعِمُوا الطَّعَامُ, would it have had the same effect on Abdullah ibn Salam or not? And that's actually what I want us to just think deeply about, inshallah ta'ala, as we move forward with this community and take it to that next level. People will not remember what you said. People will not remember what you did. People will remember how you made them feel. So Maya Angelou said, I didn't say it's a hadith. Sometimes I quote Maya Angelou and then someone puts it on Twitter, it's a hadith. It says, Sheikh Omar said it at a fundraising dinner. I'm like, no, I just like to quote Maya Angelou. Deal with it. All right? People will not remember what you did. People will not remember what you said. People will remember how you made them feel. I heard that in grief counseling, learning grief counseling. If you think about when you're going through a hardship, and a lot of times, by the way, people find their way back to Allah in hardship, right? That's when their first time coming back to the masjid is, or at least in a very serious way. I want you to think about a time when you were in deep hardship, all right? When you were going through something. The two people you probably remember, you remember people that were present. You remember, and when I say present, you remember someone who gave you a real hug, who you saw sincerity and pain and grief in their eyes. You saw that they really, really felt for you in those moments. I think back to my mother's janazah, rahmatullahi alayha, most painful days of my life. I don't remember anything anyone said to me. I remember certain hugs. I remember certain eyes. I remember certain tears. I can't quote anybody from those days. And so that resonated with me right away. You know what the second thing you remember is? Someone who said something really inappropriate. So it's either someone who said something really out of place, right, that really upset you, or someone that was very present, but you usually don't remember anything else about people. Those are the two things that you remember in your moments of pain and hardship. And subhanAllah, that lesson is so laced in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and you think about some of the most beautiful lessons that we take from the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, from his advices to the people that were around him. And so much of it had to do with his body language. So much of it had to do with the setting, with the scene. Things that cannot be translated through text. But you have to sit there and ponder and think, how did the Prophet ﷺ, how was he sitting when he said that? Who was he sitting with? Where were they sitting? What did he look like? What was the tone that he probably employed? Sometimes the hadith will actually mention a tone that the Prophet ﷺ employed or a facial expression that the Prophet ﷺ had. And I want you to think about some of the deepest advices that we have and most transformative advices that we have in our tradition because of the way that the Prophet ﷺ spoke to a person when he spoke to them. One of the most transformative hadiths that we have in the 40 hadith of Imam An-Nawawi is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah says that I was riding with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was a ghulam, he was about 10 years old. Young man, riding on the back of a riding animal with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned around and he put his hand on his shoulders and he said, Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimat. Oh young man, I'm going to teach you some words. Let me give you some words of advice. What proceeds of the hadith, had Ibn Abbas heard that hadith on the minbar, do you really think it would have transformed him the way that it transformed him and had the same impact on us that it had? It is the beginning of the hadith that's so important. And Ibn Abbas, by the way, if you study hadith literature, is the most descriptive of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ when he narrates. He gives you the whole scene. And some of them just say that's his brilliance, that's his showing, his thiqah, his trustworthiness, that I know what I saw and I know what I heard. I can give you the entire context and recreate it for you, and it puts you right back into it. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, he says that the Prophet ﷺ turned around like someone that really was deeply vested in my upbringing, someone that really cared about what I was going to become, someone that just by the way he's looking at me, just by that environment, just by him putting his hands on my shoulders, making eye contact with me, is showing me that I'm worth his time, that he sees something in me. Because this is the Prophet of Allah. He sees something in me. Otherwise, he wouldn't waste his time with me like that. And he says to me, احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. Be mindful of Allah, and Allah will protect you. Be mindful of Allah, and you will find him in front of you. إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. If you ask, ask of Allah. And if you seek help, then seek help of Allah. And know that if the entire ummah was to gather together, if all people were to gather together to benefit you with something, لَمْ يَنْفَعُوكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ. They would not be able to benefit you with anything unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written it for you. And in اجتمعوا, if they were all to get together, عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ, to hurt you with something. لَمْ يَضُرُّوكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ. They would not be able to harm you except with something, قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ, that Allah has written upon you. رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامُ وَجَفَّتِ الصُّحُفُ, the pens have been lifted and the pages have dried. That advice is so perfectly crafted to Ibn Abbas. That advice, as eloquent and as beautiful as it is, would not have had the same impact on a minbar, on the pulpit. That's the type of advice, that type of conversation happens after the halaqa. That type of conversation happens in one of your homes out of a relationship that you've made in the masjid. Those types of conversations, those types of relationships, those types of life-changing advices, those types of transformative moments that help carry people through their most difficult times, those happen through so much more than messaging. But it's every single thing about the masjid. What feel does it give to you? Does the masjid give you a feeling of welcomeness? And when I'm saying welcomeness, you know, your minds might be thinking about certain things, right? It's something so simple. SubhanAllah, the sign that's on the door is about welcomeness, right? It doesn't mean literally just write welcome, right? There was, mashallah, Sheikh Waleed in Houston, right? Clear Lake Islamic Center. They did something cool we haven't done yet. They let all the youth write. Maybe you guys can incorporate this in your project. But everyone write their favorite quote. They have a board where you can write a quote, an inspiring quote, where people can come and contribute, write their own favorite quotes. And they walk in, and that's something they can look at. That's empowering. That's inspiring. What does the masjid tell you when you walk into it? What are the smiles like? What are the people like? If your name is not known, do people take a moment or do people take the time to actually learn who you are? Ask you what your name is. Ask you what your story is. How many of those ahadith arise out of those moments? That personal advice with both the sahabi and the sinner, with the Bedouin and the person who lived next door to the masjid. Every single person had a story. And I don't want to just put that all on the imam. That's not all on the leadership. Because I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes the way that one person acts, and this is the reality, and I don't want to end on a bad note, but it's so much easier to destroy something good than to establish something. So sometimes the actions of one person in a community can hurt someone so bad that it can undo the entire strategy and thought and everything that went into making everyone walk in this masjid feel welcome. And just one person can ruin it all, right? And sometimes a very good community can be spoiled. Fitnatu na'ima, la'ana Allahu man ayqadaha. The Prophet ﷺ taught us this idea, right? Fitna is asleep always amongst the people. May Allah curse the one who wakes it up. Ya'malu an-namam min sa'atin fitnata ashhur. As Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, a person goes and starts spreading things around and they can destroy in 1 hour what took months to establish, right? Fitna, a fitna that would last for months. So that capacity to go wrong, to trigger something, to set things on fire, of course it's always there. But the more you create culture, and culture is not something you fundraise for. Culture is in the way that you fundraise. Culture is in the way that you interact with people, beyond just the donations and beyond just the fundraising and things of that sort. Culture, how you create culture in your community, how you avoid becoming cliquish and keeping people locked out when they don't belong in that community, when they move in, and unless they have something to offer, they're not going to be inducted into the fraternity of that community. That's culture. That's what the Prophet ﷺ taught us to create. Could you imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a person walking into his masjid and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not paying attention to who he was or who she was, right? And so much of it, by the way, and this is the last thing that I want to mention, every single person that walks into your masjid, even if they're just a musalli, even if they're just someone that's there to pray, is a valuable element of your community and a potential contributor. Someone who could be unlocked to something so much greater that would help fulfill them and be better for the community. What I mean by that is, you know, when you look at the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he noticed when people were missing from the masjid. He noticed when people were missing from the masjid, right? And the people that he noticed, now if you're, and I'm saying this, by the way, as someone who utterly fails at this, right? I can't imagine the Prophet ﷺ, when he'd walk out of his door, he was swarmed. When he went back to his home, he was swarmed. People would even try to pray qiyam behind him, listening to his voice lining up behind his doors. Privacy was not really a thing for the Prophet ﷺ. Surat al-Hujurat was revealed for a reason, people calling out to him even in his room at night, right? He didn't really have much of that. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he comes to the masjid, it would be so easy for him to miss the subtle follower because of the presence of the adoring companions that created this aura around him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he asked, he said, hey, where is so-and-so? Has anyone seen this person? Has anyone seen that person? And it was not for the sake of gossiping. It wasn't to say, I was on their Instagram the other day. It doesn't look too good, right? Saw him on Facebook. You know, before social media, it was like, yeah, I saw her at the mall. It was something like that, right? Now it's, I saw them on social media. There's a reason they're not there. Pfft, done. There's no good in that person, right? You put it all on the person. Instead of thinking as a community, how do we bring them back? What did we do maybe to run them off? Maybe we contributed to that. Maybe we're complicit. How do we bring them back? It's, well, guess they're not part of this anymore. The Prophet ﷺ did not ask about people to gossip about them. He didn't ask about them to indicate that they'd done something wrong. He asked about them out of genuine concern. That's the woman who was cleaning the masjid that the Prophet ﷺ noticed the very next day was missing. And yes, the Prophet ﷺ noticed Uthman radiallahu anhu was missing. Hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, the Prophet ﷺ noticed a very random man. The Sahaba did not even realize he wasn't attending anymore. And the Prophet ﷺ said, anyone heard about this man, so-and-so? And they said, yeah. Ya Rasulullah, we heard he lost someone in his family. The Prophet ﷺ said, let's go find him. Let's go find him. They find him, and it turns out his son died, and the Prophet ﷺ makes dua for him, asks about him, inquires about him. Those are things from the sunnah that we really, really need to prioritize in creating community. All of the sunnah is worth it. All of the sunnah is worth it. But what did the Prophet ﷺ establish a community upon, and how do we maintain that? And don't think just because you have something good now that you're necessarily going to have it as you move into the next phase of your community. You need to be intentional about maintaining what good you already have and then building upon that good. That's what the khutbah was about. Ihsan is taking what's good and making it better. Ihsan is taking what's good and making it better. The Prophet ﷺ would not walk out to his mezzah and say, well, we're done. This looks like a pretty successful experiment to me. He was vested to the very last moment. To the very last moment, the Prophet ﷺ was checking on his companions. He's still looking out his curtain when he can't even move his body anymore, when he's between consciousness, and smiling, huge smile at the sight of the Sahaba praying. He was vested to the very last moment. And even the last two groups of people the Prophet ﷺ visited were the martyrs of Uhud and the deceased ones that were in Al-Baqir. So he didn't even forget the deceased ones in his community, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his last days. The last people he visited when he was healthy, he went out to the Uhud and visited those martyrs, went out to the Baqir, made dua for them in the graveyard, and then looking out with whatever he could, coming out to the prayer for as long as he could, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before his health would not allow him to do so anymore. Being vested to the very, very last moment. So what's good, make it better. Put ihsan into it. Take pride in it, not in a way that makes you arrogant, but in a way that humbles you with the opportunity to set a trend for other masjids to start thinking, hey, how do we become more like RCM? That's when you know you're making it, inshallah. And not how do we become more like RCM because they raised, how much are y'all trying to raise tonight? $1 million. Because they raised $1 million. We want to be like RCM. They raise $1 million. We want to be like RCM because that community does something different. That, you know, this is sabiqu. Compete with one another in good. How do you become the most welcoming and sunnah-like masjid in this region? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help you and help us to live up to those ideals of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah allow us to emulate him in our community lives, in our family lives, in our worship, in our work, in everything that we do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be a means of connecting people to him and not be a people that turn people away from him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never allow us to be an obstacle or a hindrance to someone in their path towards good or in their faith. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those that are guided and guided through, rectify our hearts and rectify hearts through us, that have inner peace within them and that emanate peace to everything that is around them. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.